Hello and welcome to this presentation titled Exploring Audio Circuits with Modeling Toolkit. I am Gkountouras and I'm currently applying for scientific machine learning PhDs. I'm also working on some audio related projects that will appear today. We will cover our reasons for choosing Modeling Toolkit, some patterns such as inheritance and composition. We will also see examples of audio circuits, some simple, some more complex, and we will define some components that are useful for audio circuit simulation. We will see how to get audio in and out of our model, and finally we will see some new innovations such as differential programming. The talk will conclude with audio demos. So why choose Modeling Toolkit? In the audio tech industry, usually we begin with a circuit measurement. We make spice models of our components, and we also have the schematic that shows how they are connected. Then we make a prototype in Python, MATLAB, Scilab, or some other software. And finally, we write production code using C++ for efficiency. Something that we need to address is there always a circuit to measure. Sometimes we only have access to a schematic, or if we're working on original designs, this means that we don't have anything yet. We are exploring different variations. For this talk, we will assume we have spice models of our components. So, what is spice? It's a family of circuit modeling software. So, any circuit simulators are collectively known as spice. Some of these tools have a graphical environment where we can drag and drop components into our schematic. Others are command line utilities that are better suited for automation. There are also others that focus on parallel execution or online applications. And an advantage of spice is that we can define functions using the func directive. Of course, the only way to control everything is to write our own circuit simulator that resembles spice. This means that we have strong guarantees on operating in real time. And in practice, this would be in C++ for efficiency reasons. A disadvantage of this method is the huge amount of effort required. Another option is to use Mathematica, which in my experience does prevent phone calls to mathematicians. It has the best symbolics and we can define functions in these languages. It also has System Modeler, which is their environment for simulating systems. It can even export a simulation executable. And there are blog posts by Leonardo Laguna Ruiz, who worked on System Modeler. He writes about modeling audio circuits, and he rewrites the real-time implementation in C++. A different option is using MATLAB. It has its own system modeling environment called Simulink. We define functions in a DSL called Simscape, and it has better numerical algorithms than Mathematica, but the symbolic manipulations are worse. It can also export C code, although you might want to rewrite it in practice. And of course, both Mathematica and MATLAB need a license for each end user they are deployed to, not just for the developer. So that makes deployment hard. Some people use Python for circuit modeling. We don't have access to a graphical environment, but we can at least plot the output. We can also define functions to include in the solver, and some of it is even differentiable. We get access to symbolics, but again, it is not as good as Mathematica. we can call external numerical solvers in other languages for efficiency. However, one of the problems with Python is that its libraries don't compose in general, and also we have no real-time guarantees. And this brings us to Modeling Toolkit, which is the Julia equivalent to the previous solutions. We still don't have access to a drag-and-drop environment, but we can plot our output. Functions are general Julia code. They are differentiable using automatic differentiation. They can work in real time, and we also have access to symbolics, which is not as good as Mathematica, but it is improving. We also have access to a lot of numerical solvers, either in Julia or external, and in general, the ecosystem has permissive licensing. Although I don't have any personal experience, I also have to mention Cider, which is a commercial application built on top of Modeling Toolkit, so it has the same advantages, but in addition to that, it has a graphical environment where we can design our schematic using drag and drop. We can also import SPICE circuit descriptions, and we can train models using cloud resources. The first pattern that we need to look at is inheritance. Of course, the Modeling Toolkit standard library already includes the standard SPICE components like resistor or capacitor, but it's still useful to understand how we would define them manually. So this is one port. It has two pins, the positive pin and a negative pin, and two states, the current going through the component and the voltage across each node. This is the inheritance pattern. We can define a resistor, which is a one port, and the capacitor, which is also a one port. This means that we avoid repeating information and we only add the specific laws of each component. For example, for a resistor, we would add Ohm's law. This is our first complete example. It is a second order low-pass filter. It consists of two cascaded resistor-capacitor stages. And we also have a convenience function called connect that makes it easy to define our system equations. As we can see in the graph, the output is indeed a low-pass version of the input. I also chose this example because it showcases another effect of analog systems, which is loading. This means that each stage affects its next stages, but it also affects its previous stages. We can avoid this to make it behave as a digital system by including buffers between the stages. The next pattern that we're going to look at is composition, how we combine elements to create larger systems. This is our first system. It's a voltage controlled current source, or VCCS. Note that there is a negative sign in the equation that defines this component. Then we can use our previously defined VCCS to define a vacuum tube, also known as a triode. The values displayed here are those that belong to a 12AX7 triode. We see how easy it is to use the connect utility to describe our system. Note that this is not how triodes actually work. It's only a simplification for the linear range of operation, and we can also access the states of our subsystem, for example, the voltage across our grid to cathode capacitor. Another option that we would like to have is controls. In real hardware, this would be knobs connected to potentiometers, but here in our model we have virtual potentiometers. Conceptually, those consist of two variable resistors. We define a variation with 3 pins and also a variation with 2 pins, which is a single variable resistor, because sometimes it is cleaner to define a variable resistor. Another topic related to potentiometers is the response of the potentiometer or the taper. Usually we use logarithmic taper for volume or frequency controls, because that is how humans hear, and we also limit the rotation to prevent singular systems. There are other tapers that are possible, for example anti-logarithmic, or we could model the cheap potentiometers that only have two linear ranges instead of a logarithmic response. And this is the logarithmic response of our potentiometer. So for a complete example, let's start by defining a diode. We use the Shockley equation that we can see at the bottom. And we use a variation that is called linear continuation diode. This comes from a library by Martin Holters, which is also written in Julia. And of course, Holters uses a different syntax than SPICE circuit descriptions. This variation means that we prevent numerical explosion in our simulation. There is a conditional inside the expression. We cannot use a regular conditional from the Julia language. We have to use the if-else from the if-else package. And this is our complete example. It is the clipper section of a tube screamer distortion pedal. We switch to a nonlinear solver because this is a nonlinear system, and we use an expression for the anti-parallel diodes that is a hyperbolic sine. We see that the distortion in this case is symmetric. If we only use one diode instead of anti-parallel diodes, we get a asymmetric distortion for different values of our distortion knob. And we can also change the values of our diode to a germanium, to correspond to a germanium diode, which is also asymmetric but has a different characteristic. And the last two examples show that we can combine these subsystems. For example, we can have 3 germanium diodes in addition to a symmetry control in the forward direction, and we can have 2 silicon diodes in series with a constant resistance in the backwards direction, and we see the different response for as we change the controls. So how do we get audio in and out of our model? The easiest method is to simply read the file from disk, create an interpolating function, register that interpolating function in Modeling Toolkit, and get voltage samples from the output pin as reference to ground. Then we write the output to disk using WAV.JL. Note that there are better interpolators than cubic. For example, we would use a windowed sync if we wanted a better option. So we can process audio. Can we do it in real time? Our first attempt is to embed Julia in our C++ audio plugin. For this, we're using the JLuna library, which presents a friendly user interface to the Julia C API. The first function that you call in the C API is JLinit, which already fails when I tried it. What is the problem? The problem here is that the Julia C API cannot be accessed from a C-side thread that is not master. In this case, master means the thread that main is executed in. The plugin API doesn't provide any guarantees about threading. I would like to stress again that this is a limitation of the C API. It is not a limitation of our wrapper. And it also crashed when I tried it with the plain C API. I also found references to a CCMatch method, which is another attempt to include Julia in an audio plugin. There are some posts discussing these methods. They may or may not work depending on the version of Julia you're using, the libraries you're using, which platform you are on, and when you tried it. A disadvantage with this method is that even when it works, it creates huge applications because you are essentially shipping an entire Julia runtime. Another attempt, since we cannot include Julia in our audio plugins, is to see if we can at least have real-time audio processing. For this, we use the Port Audio library in addition to Modeling Toolkit. We define an integrator from differential equations, we make it stop at each audio sample, and we process buffers for efficiency. And we see that this way we get real-time audio processing. What if we could statically compile Julia code and then load it in a dynamic manner inside our dynamic audio plugin? This leads us to our third attempt, which is static compiler. We define this very simple function and then we load it on the C++ side inside our audio plugin. Then we get the Julia function from the C++ side and we can call it to process audio. This makes it the first audio plugin to be written in Julia. Unfortunately, when we try it with the differential equations integrators, the abstract types means that static compiler will fail to compile our program. However, we can still create traditional DSP processing methods. And we get all the advantages of Julia, such as macros and multiple dispatch. You should also check out the static tools, which is a great library. So it is ready for production. Should we all write our audio plugins in Julia? Well, this is an experimental compiler on unsupported at the time of writing the code Apple Silicon using a beta version of Julia. Still, this is something that works today and you can try it. And since we are on Apple Silicon, this leads us to an interesting experiment. We have access to a GPU via the Metal API, which means that we can send our audio to the GPU, process it there, and then transfer it back to the CPU for playback. It works, and it works in real time, which is somewhat surprising. So this makes it the first time that GPU audio has been demonstrated to work on Apple Silicon. And it showcases the power of multiple dispatch because we no longer need to adapt our algorithms for Silicon, CPU and GPU. We can instead let multiple dispatch take care. Another interesting innovation is differentiable digital signal processing, which has been extended to differential analog signal processing. This is the practice of predicting the values of components as parameters in our model, for example, a resistance or a capacitance. In order to create a differential programming in Modeling Toolkit, we first define our model, then we define our loss function, which is the difference between what the model predicts and what we measured from the actual circuit. We differentiate that loss with regard to parameters using automatic differentiation, and we optimize to find the best parameters. Note that currently a parameter indexing workaround is required for this method. And here are some audio demos using the systems we defined previously. First, this is muted guitar, our input. And here is how the tube screamer clipping section responds to this input. First, anti-parallel diodes with some mild distortion. Then a more extremely clipped variation. Then we see the asymmetric distortion using a silicon diode. And the last two examples are also asymmetric. They use a germanium diode, first with mild distortion, and then with more distortion. What can we look forward to in the future? First, hopefully at some point we will be able to statically compile more of Julia. We would also like to be able to export to embedded platforms. For example, static compiler has already been demonstrated to work with Arduino. Perhaps we could find a way to export to an FPGA or an embedded GPU even. We would also like to have better coverage of traditional audio algorithms in Julia libraries, for example, variations of the Fourier transform, such as the constant Q transform and the short time Fourier transform. And it would be nice to have a sync interpolator. Finally, here are some resources for further study. Thank you for your attention.